which was an application to baseball, but it actually is broader than that. And then we'll see some other examples of or some other issues related to that. Okay, so the setup I introduced last time is that you're towards the end of some season, and each team in the league has won a certain number of games, and has a certain pattern of games left to play, that is, games with particular other teams. So let's just focus on team X, and just to establish some notation, has already won WX games, and has, let's see what this, I think it's GX games left to play. So certainly if the team, if X wins all the rest of their games, then so can win a total of, call it MX equals, okay? So if they win all the rest of their games, then they certainly have won that many. Now, the issue was, and let's do some other notation first. Team X has GXY games to play with team Y. Okay. So at this point in the season, let's say that the team that's won the most number of games has won some number Q. Okay, so the leader has won Q games. All right, so in order for our team X to ever be the leader at the end, we certainly need GX, that's MX, greater than or equal to Q. That's if our team is going to win or tie for the lead. So the opposite situation is what the book calls, say, the terminology the book uses is that the team is eliminated. If MX cannot be, if X cannot ever either win the most number of games or tie for the most number of games, then team X is eliminated. So this is certainly a simple necessary condition. You need MX to be greater than or equal to Q. But what I asked last time where we stopped is this sufficient? If MX is greater than or equal to Q, does that necessarily mean that there's actually a scenario, a win-loss scenario for the rest of the games such that team X is not eliminated, such that team X either wins the most number of games or ties for the most number of games? What's the answer? Well, the answer is no, otherwise we wouldn't be talking about this, right? Because it would just be too simple, right? Although we'll actually see something related to this in a bit. But no, the point is that this is necessary, but it's not sufficient. The point being that just look at the leader. The leader's won Q games, and the leader has some more games to play. So when the leader loses, or when any team loses, it loses to some other team. So even if X wins all the rest of their games and the present leader loses all the rest of their games, well, that leader is going to be losing to some other teams, and so their total is going to be increasing as well. And so there's no simple rule like this, it looks like, no simple rule. Well, this simple rule, anyway, would not be sufficient to determine whether or not X can end up being the overall winner or tied for being the winner. You need something more sophisticated, okay? And what is that something? It's network flow. Network flow is certainly one way of doing this. So what we're really going to try to do is allocate the wins and losses so that our team X ends up as the winner, okay? So we're going to allocate through a network flow. We're going to actually come up with a scenario, if there is one, so that our team ends up being at least not eliminated, either tied or equal or strictly the winner. So we're going to have one node here for each team, each pair, PQ. And we're going to have one node over here. So this is each pair of teams. OK, and here we're going to have each team. Actually, this is, that's OK. So each team is going to be over here, and in particular, P and Q will be over here. And then we'll have a terminal node. So what this is going to be is how many games are left between P and Q. We're going to be allocating, we're going to be distributing the wins and losses. So from S, we're going to flow to this node. We're going to have a capacity here which is equal to the number of games left between P and Q. And the winner of each one of those games could either be P or it could be Q. Okay, so in will come P, this many games, if you want to think of it that way. And out will come the number of those games that P wins and the number that Q wins. Okay, now, of course, over here we could have QX. No, I don't want an X. That's our special team. QZ. Okay, so Z is another one over here. And so that goes there as well, and Z goes over there, and this is the number of games between Q and Z. All right, so the whole picture is much more complicated. We have one node over here for each pair of teams, and one node over here for each team. Yeah?
The team that you're trying to run the scenario for, X, in
yeah.
this case, you want to make sure is not in the graph.
Yeah, okay, so we could either put it in there or not. Here's a simple observation. If there's a way of distributing the wins, so that X comes out either tied or ahead, then certainly if X wins all the rest of their games, it will come out tied or ahead. Okay. So we can assume that X is just going to win all the rest of their games. All right. So all the games that involve X, you're right. If we had explicitly an X here, you'll see in a minute what we would do with it, but we can actually take it out. So let's, for the moment, put it in there. And so if we have games that involve X, let's say here's PX. Okay, this is the number of games left between P and X. Then that will go there, and that will go there. All right? We'll see in a minute we can actually take out this, and we can take out anything strictly involving X, because we can assume that X is going to win all the remaining games. But for the moment, let's leave that in there. Okay, so we've laid out essentially something that represents the rest of the schedule, the rest of the games to be played. Every pair of teams, every individual team, and then some edges here that can be used to distribute the wins. Now, we're trying to see whether X can end up as the overall winner or as the or tied to be the winner. Okay, so X, we want to win MX games. We want them to win. X should win all the rest of their games, because certainly if there's a way for X to be the winner or the tied for the winner, if X wins all the rest of their games, then that's just as good. So we're going to put a lower here, a lower bound of MX. So we're just going to say you have to put that much flow through there. Okay, that will mean that X is going to win all the rest of its games. And what should we put for P, for this edge? Okay. Well, this whole flow is supposed to determine whether or not X can be the winner or tied for the winner. And P so far has won, according to this notation, WP games, all right, and has GX games left to play. All right, so how many games can P be allowed to win if X is going to end up being the winner? So we don't want p in the end to have won more than mx, right? In the end, we don't want p to have won more than mx. But p has already won wp, right? So if we put an upper bound here of that difference, that says we're going to let p win at most this many games and no more. And if that happens, then the total that p wins at the end is no more than mx. Mx is the amount that we've decided that x will win. And then what capacity should we put in the middle? And again, the overall idea is that we're going to be distributing the wins from all the games left to play so that no team ends up winning more than mx games. So let me just put another one in here just to be, this would be mx minus wq. And what capacity should we put in the middle? Yeah, there's no harm in making this infinite. You could be as small, perhaps, on this edge as gpq. And that's the number of games left to play between p and q. You could make that gpq and make that gpq. But there's no harm in making this infinity. So right now, so let's just state the theorem. One more piece of definition here. G star is equal to the summation gpq. Okay, so this is just the total number of games left to play. Left to play. Okay. So, and here I'm including those games that involve x. That's fine. So now I have a theorem here which says that there is a way for x to tie or strictly win if and only if the flow value equals g star. So g star is really the total here. Or this cut is has capacity g star. So this should, if you understood the construction, then this should be very clear. This is just saying, here are all the games that are left to play. And each one is, if it's a game between P and Q, it's either P is going to win or Q is going to win. And this is putting a bound on how many we can allow P to win. This is a bound on how many Q can win. And then this is a lower bound on how many x must win. All right. And so if there is a flow in here which saturates this cut, if it's a flow of value g star, then we've actually found a scenario, described at least the existence of a scenario for all the future games, who's going to win and who's going to lose, so that x ends up tying or winning the most number of games. Nobody has more games than one than x does. Conversely, if there's a scenario, if I can tell you, okay, this game is going to be won by p, this is going to be won by q, and so on, you can just map that win-loss scenario onto here. You will have allocated all of the, if there's a win-loss scenario where x ends up winning the most number of games are tying, then you can just take that scenario and map it onto here as a flow. You've said exactly how each game will be resolved, who's going to win and who's going to lose, and therefore you know what the flow along these two edges, if it's a game between P and Q, is. And you've taken care of all the future games, so the flow in here is going to be equal to G star, and all the constraints are satisfied. Does everybody see that? So this actually was first done, I don't know, the 1940s or so, in 1950s. It was done through linear programming, and then later people saw that you could do this with network flow. Now, one thing that I mentioned earlier is that the book doesn't include X, and it doesn't include lower bounds. And that should be clear to see why. We've decided here that X is going to win all of its future games. And we impose that by having a lower bound here. So the flow in here must equal, it's a lower bound and also the capacity is that many. So the flow in here is exactly mx. We know what that flow is exactly going to be. And therefore, we know that in all the future games involving x, we know who's winning that. So that's a portion of the flow here that's already specified, a portion of the ST flow that's already specified in this solution, the solution that we have here. So you can just erase this, erase all the edges that touch X, and erase all of the pairs that involve X. And then G star is again going to be defined as not the total of all the games left to play, but the total of the edges that are out of S, because the total of the capacities on the edges that are out of S, because that G star then is just talking about what's all the remaining games that don't involve X, because we already know that games involving X, X will win. So there's no issue about that. But this is still going to be the same, because this is exactly how many we will allow that team to win. It's just that they'll now have to win that many games with even fewer opportunities, because the games against X, they'll definitely lose. Well, that was true here as well, but now it's just built in there. So everything else remains the same. So you can just simplify this a little bit, and that's the way the book does it. It doesn't have X in there at all. I think that's the answer to your question. And you asked at the very beginning, should we even include X at all? Okay. So you can decide whether X can win or tie for winning. Now, I've always found it annoying in this exposition that they include tying along with strictly winning. I mean, so this whole thing is always described in terms of, is Team X eliminated? And eliminated means that they can't tie and can't win, okay? So eliminated means that under every possible scenario, the winner strictly wins more than X does. And it just seems like a very clumsy thing. It seems like the more natural question is, can X strictly win? Okay. So if you've understood this lecture, you should be able to modify this very, very simply to figure out what to do to figure out whether X can strictly win Yeah, so that's the question. That's the first question on your next homework that'll be posted this evening. So you might already have solved it by the time you leave class today. And so you'll be that much ahead on your next homework. Okay. Now, let me tell you a little bit about two things I want to tell you about this. So this was the status up till about, about 7 or 8 years ago. You could focus on any particular team and find out whether that team had a chance to tie or to win, or whether that team was necessarily eliminated. And you could do that computation for every team separately by setting up a network flow focusing on that particular team. Well, this was the flow problem for X, and that was fine. But suppose you wanted to know that for every team. So we have a more general problem, determine for each team X, if X is eliminated, is necessarily, however you spelled necessarily, eliminated. Okay, So according to what I've shown you so far, yeah.
Why is this fx minus wpi? I didn't get that. It's from p to t.
This one?
Yeah. It's the number of wins for p, right?
Well, wp is the number of wins that p is already.
Right.
Yeah.
So what is that edge?
Okay, so mx is the number of wins that team x will end up with. And this is the difference between the two. Okay, so this is how many at most we can allow P to win. Of the remaining games that P is involved with, this is how many that we can allow P to win if we don't want X to be eliminated. If P wins more than this game, this many games, then P will definitely have more than MX total wins, and X will be eliminated by P, if not in addition by some other teams. Okay, so that's why we put that bound. That's a capacity of that. Yeah, so capacity. And it's the upper capacity as opposed to this one, which was both lower and upper. Okay. So the general problem is now we wanted to determine for each team, has that team been eliminated? And not just our favorite team. And in fact, there's a website, I guess there are a couple of them maybe, that follow various sports, baseball, some football, basketball, some other sports, that will, as the season goes along, it calculates this for every team and some other additional information as well. And I guess it's helpful for gamblers try to figure out. I mean, for example, suppose you had figured out through one of these calculations that Team X has absolutely no hope of ever becoming the winner. And you could see that because of there's no flow whatsoever that gives a scenario where X is the winner. But maybe everybody else is thinking naively like this, that MX is greater than Q, therefore maybe there's some hope. And so even though, you know, it may be a small difference, it might give you some advantage as a gambler to have that knowledge that there's no way that X can win as long as you can find somebody else who's still willing to bet that X can win. Okay, so at any rate, there's a website that does this calculation for every team as the season goes along and gets that kind of information. But nobody until about 7 years ago noticed that there's a correlation, there's a structure that relates the answers, all these different answers, if they're n teams, they're n different answers, and there's an actual structural relationship between those answers. And so there's all that information from each season, but it turns out that there's a fairly simple rule that connects the answers to all of the different questions. So we have n questions, you know, for n different teams. If we have n different teams, we have n questions. And what I've shown you over here is how you can solve one of those questions. And what people had done, and they probably still do, well, what they had done was just answer that question independently of all the other questions. Okay, so here's a theorem. There exists, all right, there is a number, W star, such that any team X can win or tie for the lead if and only if WX is greater than or equal to W star. So there is one particular number that is, if you looked at all these answers of whether X was eliminated or not, and you did that for each one of the teams, you would have been able to notice that there's a, well, you might not have been able to figure out what this W star is, but you might have noticed that There's just a single number which discriminates, differentiates between those teams that have a chance to win and those teams that are already eliminated. And if you could calculate this W star quickly, then you could answer all of these n different questions quickly just by doing this comparison. You wouldn't have to run a network flow for each one. And in fact, you can find W star by a single network flow. So it turns out that what looked like initially you would have to do n different network flow calculations, one for each team, you can just do a single network flow calculation, but I haven't shown you what it is. And then you would know W star, and then you could figure out who was eliminated just by doing this comparison. All right. So question? I'm going to prove this without actually telling you. Question, sorry.
Didn't that should be MX instead of WX?
Yes, I'm sorry. Yeah, good. MX, right. Yeah, the total that X could possibly win. Yeah. So I started out by saying there is no simple rule. Well, this simple rule doesn't work. Okay? To just look at what the present leader is, that wouldn't be enough. But it turns out that there is sort of another simple rule that looks like this. It's just that finding this W star is not always so easy. Okay? It is actually easy in baseball, but not in some other sports. Okay, so let me prove this theorem. And I'm actually going to prove it in the context not just of baseball, although this whole business began just by looking at baseball, but also in other kinds of sports like European football and bridge and who knows what else. Okay, so all I mean by this is the following.